Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back. As a starting point for our next session, I'm delighted to introduce a video message from the international leader responsible for ensuring that the European model of development evolves in line with new global realities. So let's hear now from the European Commission Commissioner for International Partnerships, Jutta Urpilainen.
After a challenging year and a half, COVID-19 continues to impact our lives, societies, and economies. At the same time, democracy has come under increased attack and inequalities are increasing. Around the world, non-democratic regimes are tightening their grip on power.
Media censorship, the spread of disinformation, violations of human rights. The list goes on. And the biggest victims are again the same. The most vulnerable, women and young people, pay the highest price.
History is a great teacher and provides us an important lesson. We only achieve systemic change through a collective commitment to democracy and the rule of law. We must do the same again. Europe aspires to a global rule-based order, one that curbs power politics, protects the vulnerable, and builds open societies. We have together fight corruption and disinformation and protect democracy. The EU's joint communication on multilateralism outlines our vision, but to achieve it, we need bold, ambitious thinking, the kind of thinking this forum generates.
Jutta Urpilainen, thank you. So that call we just heard from the Commissioner is one that's gone out repeatedly at this year's policy dialogue. Democracies are under increased attacks and inequality is increasing. Change can only happen through a collective commitment, we've heard. Democracy can only be saved if everyone works together. And we'll pick up these ideas in our next session, Dialogue on Democracy Assistance, with the support of an outstanding facilitator. I'm delighted to introduce the facilitator of this session, Larry Diamond, the Senior Fellow at the Hoover Institution at Stanford University. Larry, you're very welcome. Good afternoon, and over to you.
Thank you very much, and thank the Commissioner Urpilainen for those very powerful and apt framing remarks. I'll try to briefly add to them and perhaps put a little more edge to them, though I know you have had a session on the crisis we're at now, the growing global recession of democracy in the world. And so you're probably aware of all the following points, but let me make them from a social science perspective. First of all, I'd say it's important that we not be too despairing. We're still at a point where there are many more democracies than there were, say, in 1989 or when the Soviet Union collapsed in 1991. It is actually, in my evaluation, no longer the case that the majority of states over 1 million population are democracies, but nearly half still are. And the problem, as I'm sure you've already explored, however, is that the momentum is mainly in the wrong direction. And we've just seen, I think, a breakdown of democracy in Tunisia. We've seen coups against military coups against democratic openings or semi-democracies in Burma, and then in the last few days in Sudan. And all of this is happening because of a global environment in which the enemies of democracy, civilian and military, perceive very little cost to realizing their authoritarian ambitions, and in which we need to honestly note this in the case of Tunisia. A lot of ordinary people who in principle would prefer to live under a democratic system saw their actual democratic system or institutions failing them in terms of corruption, in terms of economic improvement and growth, in terms of giving their lives more hope and opportunity. And as a result, again, I don't want to overstress this. I think we need to look at this in a full and historical perspective. There still is substantial support for democracy in the world among ordinary people, but it is slipping. Public trust and faith in politicians and public frustration, if not disgust, with corruption, particularly in Latin America, but elsewhere in the world, is growing. And this is happening at a time when China and Russia in particular are vastly increasing their influence through means that we call sharp power. The penetration of democratic societies and the effort to achieve influence and to tarnish, undermine, or destroy democracy through means that are, to quote the former Australian Prime Minister Malcolm Turnbull, covert, coercive, or corrupting, and quite often all three of those. To complete my analytic portrait, I would say two things. Number one, this has been going on. I've been warning about the fact that we had entered a global recession of democracy for a decade. And it's been accelerating in its momentum and in its negative impact on democracy in recent years. I think we've really entered what Samuel Huntington would have called a third reverse wave of democratic failure and regression. And secondly, as you've noted in your previous deliberations, this is happening in every class of regime. The liberal democracies of the world, and we have a great a former elected leader of one of them in Poland, President Kwasniewski, the liberal democracies of the world are slipping back and either becoming less liberal, or as in the case of Hungary, and I think it's extremely important for Europe to recognize this, no longer democracies at all. You know, I'll leave the distinguished president to characterize his own country, but it's in pretty bad shape in terms of democracy. The countries that were not liberal democracies, but electoral democracies, most notably India, are in many cases also under great pressure of illiberal and authoritarian populism. And I think most alarmingly, since it's the largest democracy in the world, India is at great risk of democratic failure. But Indonesia is moving backwards. Brazil is moving backwards. Mexico, I think, has an authoritarian-minded president. And of course, you've seen what's happened in terms of the polarization and democratic decay in the United States. Then the competitive authoritarian regimes are basically no longer competitive. Countries like Uganda and Cambodia, these leaders say to themselves, why bother to tolerate opposition, to tolerate any independent media, to have, in the case of Cambodia, any opposition members in the parliament? The democracies of the world are too weak to stand in our way and really impose consequences on us. They have other transactional business they have to do with us. And we can simply say to them, look, you know, if you don't like what we're doing, we'll just dive deeper into the embrace of Russia and China. And then the authoritarian regimes are becoming even more authoritarian. And you have the absolute, you know, outrageous perversity of the world preparing to hold the next climate change summit, COP27, in one of the most, you know, savage abusers of human rights in the world, General al-Sisi's Egypt. And so there's very little will at this point that I can perceive, and certainly not the coordination that you spoke of the conference resolving to be necessary to confront this. And, you know, I'll just be blunt. Whatever momentum we may mobilize in these conversations, and that the United States may be thinking it's gathering in the democracy summit that's approaching on December 9 and 10, isn't even close to confronting the scale of the problem we face. We're on the edge of a real rout of democratic values and institutions in the world. The power balance has shifted dramatically, particularly toward China, but also Russia and countries like Saudi Arabia and the United Emirates, who had a very important and underappreciated role in the demise of democracy in Tunisia. And we're going to need a lot more than just kind of ramping up democracy assistance in order to turn this back. So I hope we're going to get past the argument that we should just be giving more money to Democrats and doing things more creatively. We need us. We cannot do, in my opinion, so I'll be provocative here in closing this opening. We cannot be effective in providing democracy support if it isn't matched with the strategy of, first of all, fighting for democratic values, making the normative case for democracy, and second of all, challenging, exposing, because it's always covert, and beginning to reverse the malign influence of authoritarian actors in the world. So with that, it's a great honor to have our panelists here. I don't know to what extent I'm supposed to introduce them, but I think you know who they are. President Alexander Kwasniewski is the former two-term president of Poland, one of its more successful democratic presidents before it descended into this dark era of illiberal populism, and of course, a member of the Club of Madrid. Derek Mitchell, our former ambassador to Burma, assumed the presidency a couple of years ago of one of our premier democracy support organizations, the National Democratic Institute. Emna Jablawi is president of the International Institute in Human Development, which and can speak more about the tragedy of recent developments in Tunisia. And Jay Naidu, of course, the longtime esteemed democratic trade union leader in South Africa, is now a board member of the Mo Ibrahim Foundation. So panelists all, thank you so much. I'd like to begin by just posing the big question, and then we'll drill down. Given the current global democratic recession and the march of global authoritarianism around the world, which you're free to characterize quite differently than I just did, what do you think the world can do, the established democracies can do, international organizations and networks can do to support democracy, support Democrats, and turn back this very worrisome negative tide? I guess, President Kwasniewski, maybe we could begin with you.
Thank you very much. Well, I'm thinking about state of democracy very often because I'm here in Poland, in Warsaw. You mentioned that I was president of Poland in 1995, 2005, and it was a fantastic time for Poland, I think for the world as well. We were optimistic after collapse of Soviet Union. We had no limits. We were aware that we have some kind of end of the history, and the space for liberal democracy is huge everywhere in the world. And you know, the three main milestones of my presidency was Polish new constitution, which created democratic institutions, independent judiciary, full protection of human rights. Then it was NATO, important for the security not only of Poland, but entire Europe. And then finally, European Union, what was civilization, chance of civilization development for all of us. And what happened? Why we are in the year 2021 in such a situation that we speak firstly about illiberal ideas in Poland and Hungary. We speak about crisis of democracy, and we have really very dangerous momentum in our life. And when I try to define the problems, because I'm not fully agree with this this description that we are under attack. Democracy is under attack. Of course, we are under attack, but some attacks are because of some processes, and some attacks are because of our weaknesses as well. It's necessary to be more self-critical. That democracy was not, especially in the last 20 years, was not reacted not very correctly on some difficult challenges. And that is necessary to know. And I know that I have limited time. Please allow me to say when I see these main problems of the democracy now. First is technological changes. And that is irreversible process. It will go. But the consequence of these changes is a problem with exclusion. And I think the problem with exclusion, the people, they don't feel that they are part of some processes, some decision-making processes. That is a problem number one. And one of the reasons of Polish crisis is the question of exclusion as well, because in Poland we were too long satisfied that Polish transition is so successful that the majority is happy with this transition. We didn't see enough well that transition, like in Poland, very difficult from communism to market economy to democracy, creates beneficiaries of the reforms, but losers of the reforms as well. Losers means excluded people. And I think that the problem of these technological changes creating a lot of excluded participants of the process is number one. The second is migration, which is also not new phenomenon, because the history of mankind is the history of migrations, frankly speaking. But the problem, this waves, strong waves of migration, and they are even stronger now, because from one side we have a rich societies but aging, and we have a lot of places with a lot of people with economical problem. So migration is maybe stronger now as 20 or 30 years ago. But the problem of migration creates the question of identity. And I think that's identity. The question of identity creates a lot of good space for all kinds of nationalists, populists, etc. The third point is economy. And I think, and that's my next thesis, we underestimate consequences of the crisis, financial crisis 2008-09, etc. Because this crisis created deeper inequality as before. Richer are richer, poorer are poorer, and that is ticking bomb. That is something what, again, gives a lot of space for populists and others. And that is our mistake. That is the mistake of democratic forces. That is not, it was not created by populists. The populists are they try to use it, but this situation, but that is our mistake. The next problem, the number four, is of technological changes as well. New communication. We have new situation media, we have social media, we have a crisis of traditional forms of communication. It means that we have a crisis of traditional institutions of democracy, especially political parties. We lost our contact. We lost correct language to speak with our voters, and that is the next big problem. And the last point is geopolitics. I tell you, after collapse of Soviet Union, what I said on the beginning, we were sure that now we are going to the liberal democracies almost everywhere. Today we have the real alternative. This is alternative created by China. We can participate. What means this alternative? Chinese answer is yes, we can participate in globalization. We are very much in favor of globalization. We are ready to accept the rules of market economy. And we want to keep this autocratic political system with leading Communist Party forever. And for many places in the world, this, especially in Africa, because I've been there, I spoke with the leaders, this model is much more let's say, acceptable, interesting, even fascinating, as a model of this complicated, with all these procedures, sometimes very boring democracy. And we have to know that today, in this global scene, we have a strong competitor. That is the competition between liberal democracy and this authoritarian style or semi-authoritarian style democracy, like in China or in Russia, of course, etc. And last point, because I understand that I will have a chance to answer the next questions a little bit later on, the problem of Poland. And I think Poland is a combination of these many elements. The problem of exclusion because of this very rapid changes, this transition period in Poland, that is a problem of identity and especially very much, connected or supported by a very conservative part of Polish Catholic Church. That is a problem of inequalities which were ignored by previous governments, unfortunately, especially in the last 10 years, what gave for leading forces today a lot of chances. And that also is a question of this new type of leadership, which is the leadership able to make a politics with all forms of manipulation, fake news, consolidation of the power, nepotism, what you want. And if such political concept has very skillful leaders like Viktor Orban in Hungary or Jarosław Kaczyński in Poland, that is really extremely poisoning cocktail. That is something what is for the country very dangerous. Kaczyński and Orban, they consolidated own political base on the very high level, something around 35-40%. That is, of course, not the majority, but in the all electoral system, that is enough to win the elections and to have majority. Orban, even last year, had the constitutional majority in Hungary. So that is the reality, and we as Democrats should be much more see about our mistakes, our weaknesses, not only that we are under attack, because we are under attack. And my recipe is simple. We have to believe in our values. We have to fight for our democratic values. We have to have a better communication with our people, with the citizens, because that is our only chance to create and to strengthen civic societies in all our countries, and to be wiser after all these experiences with populists, with Donald Trump in the United States, as we were before. Thank you.
That was a truly brilliant diagnosis of the causal drivers of the crisis we're in. I think you have really hit the mark on it. And if you ever want to come and give the lecture at Stanford University, I think that our students could learn a lot from you.
Call me later about it.
I will do that. Okay. I'm really going to do that. Derek, I'd like to turn to you next, and you can build on this or you can pivot to the closing themes of the president's analysis by pondering what we can do to support democracy and support Democrats, of course, with a small d. Go ahead.
Right. Well, thank you, Larry. It's good to see you. And I thought the president's comments were really salient. I really don't quibble with any of that. And it's hard in some ways to add to it, but it is an honor to be on the panel, and thank the Club de Madrid for inviting me. Look, I think the time where organizations like NDI or the democracy community were complacent about the challenges around the world, that's long past. I mean, in the past, we all were like, well, we just plant some seeds and we build processes and structures and they'll be back and forth, but eventually they will grow and things will be fine. That time has passed. And I think we do need to be thinking much more strategically. This idea of simply looking at the structures or processes alone without looking at culture and looking at, as the president mentioned, as you mentioned, Larry, the headwinds that we're facing around the world that are fresh, But we need to be integrating that in the way we think, in the way we do our work, in the way we program, understanding precisely how China does its job, how it does its work globally, how it's penetrating societies and corrupting situations. Not only our organizations need to understand this, but we need to, and on the ground, but also make sure that countries understand how this is happening and that the communications are pretty clear about what those challenges are. Similarly, the challenges we all know from technology in the digital space, understanding both how to address those challenges, but also harness the possibilities there, because they have the ability to connect and to open up voices, new voices, and enable societies to engage in their affairs. But the bad guys have figured out quicker than we how to harness this for their ends and to subvert it, and we just have not gotten off the block. I'm thinking about both how to partner with them, but also how to harness them in the right way and ensure that information gets in, information gets through the firewalls the Chinese are promoting, so that there's conversation and their voices are being heard inside countries. So we need to be thinking about that in the support community, not just building political parties or doing elections, but these types of things. And also recognizing what you said, Larry, which is the energy that remains out there, which is enormous, that even over the past 15 years, all the measures, the metrics of democracy have regressed, but political participation has gone up in country after country. The resilience that we're seeing demonstrates the success in some ways of the work that we have done to date over the past 30 years, where in a place like Burma, or other places where they have the expectation that their voice will be heard and that, you know, we can't control if guys with guns have the same mindsets and want to preserve their power and their privilege, they will do that. And they will do it violently, and it takes time to get them to change. But, you know, people are not accepting that. They're taking to the streets. They're saying, we want our voices heard against those illiberals. And they need to be supported. There has to be a cost, as you said, Larry. We have to think about how we work together by governments and civil society to impose a cost and to demonstrate that this cannot stand, and we will stand by the billions of people that are on our side that seek what we are peddling, as it were, and not allow this narrative that democracy is on the decline to kind of get us down. The liberals would like to see us all in despair and gnashing our hands over this stuff, rather than galvanizing and seeing where the opportunities are and meeting these young people, in particular young women, young men, where they are. And they are not necessarily as interested in the institutions, but they are interested in being engaged and having a voice. We need to meet them and figure out how do we organize or help them gain some traction, have a voice in their societies in ways that they like, that they accept. But that's a harnessing of energy that we need to be thinking about. But then we have our own challenges. I mean, as President said, that this there is absolutely an attack on democracy, attacks from within, attacks from without. But the opportunities are there because of, as you say, in Tunisia, democracy didn't deliver. We talk about this a lot. Democracy must deliver. We have to figure out what that means. It can't simply be basic democracy. It has to be applied democracy. So it's not just the structure, but the democracy as we do our support work. We have to think about how do we partner with private sector, with labor, with business, with others, with development agencies writ large, on how the work that we do delivers, whether it's a job or whatever the expectation is on the ground, so that people feel this system works for it, delivers according to its expectations. We need to be thinking about that practically. This is a practical challenge. It can't just be a theoretical or a structural one. It has to be a practical one. I think we need to do more in the way we structure our support work and the way we do it as a society, as a global society, of how do we ensure it delivers. And then, of course, we are our developed democracies themselves need to be thinking about this stuff as we go. Finally, on your answer on the summit, just quickly, I don't want to go on too long, but the summit is an opportunity. The summit itself maybe underwhelming. We'll have 100 plus countries and, you know, how much can be done in 2 days. But it offers the opportunity to spotlight this question and to get, as they talk about, a year of action or leading up to the next summit. And civil society and others are galvanizing to do this. And I think this is up to us to think about, what do we want to do with this year to build momentum? And I think one of the things we have to do as a fundamental issue in the next year is to explain what is at stake, why this matters, why this is not a nice to have, and even not just why it's competitive vis-a-vis China and some great power competition, because in fact, that will work against us around the world, where people don't want to be involved in some great power competition. They're concerned about themselves and their own sovereignty. But we can explain these values of having practical value for education, for stability, for peace, but making the very hard strategic realist case that this stuff is essential. And I'll have to say very openly and candidly that I'm not sure the Biden administration gets it entirely. I think the Biden, maybe president does, some individuals do, but they are not making the strategic case. They're not embedding it into their policy. And we need to, in the United States, to lead on this, but I think Europe and Asia can help us with that. If you as you understand it, tell us we need to be thinking about this as strategic and embedding this. And I think that's what the next year should really be about, so that our support is really thought about in these various levels. So that'll be enough, and I've probably spoken too much. Thank you, Larry. You're on mute, I think.
Yeah, I'm. there's so much being said here that I can't resist the temptation as a continuing student to take notes. So I'm trying to spare you the sound of my keyboard. All right. So thank you for putting the question of the upcoming Democracy Summit more front and center. Emna Jablawi, would you like to speak next?
Hello, everybody. Do you hear me?
We hear you well. Please proceed.
Hello, Larry. Hello, my friends. So I was running from university, so sorry for not having been able to hear all Derek's intervention, but thank you, Derek, for your openness and your great remarks. So I've been a friend of Club de Madrid since 2012, and by the end of 2011, they Maria Elena raised a group with some leaders, young leaders, in this emergent democracy. We've been trying to work hard. We worked hard, but as you can imagine, after 10 years, there are very new challenges, and we have an experience now. We have also some distance to give some first evaluation of this first decade of the political transition. So if you allow me to say that I agree with Derek that there was failures in this first decade of the transition. First failure was the economical one. So no economic responses were given to the young Tunisian aspiring, having high expectation for employment, having high expectation to have solutions to improve their lives. So one of the things that we have to discuss together, what democracy have to bring and what are our priorities. If I compare our transition to the Iraqi case, or to sometimes the fragile, unhappy, maybe Afghan case too. All these changements sometimes doesn't does bring sometimes some institutions. And I always heard my friends in the free world saying, you should have free elections. You should have open elections. Okay, I agree. It's one pillar to have open free elections. It's one pillar to have institutions like presidency, parliament, government, and so on, and some possible control between institutions. But sometimes, as I said to my friends very early in the beginning of our political transition in Tunisia, I said that democracy, it's not just about free elections. It's about values. It's a package. And I was always insisting to my European and American friends, please, you have to watch Tunisia. Something is not happening well. Values are not respected. The values of democracy. So values are also transparency, not corrupted parliament, real independent body of election, which wasn't the case. So we can talk about big, big, big fragilities and big problems in our democracy. The first decade in Tunisia showed that we gave, let's say, this face, a nice face of free elections, some, let's say, formal form of democracy, but it was open to the right have more multi-party system, because we were before 2011 in, let's say, one party system. We got different parties, more than 200, but they were sometimes parties connected to smugglers, connected to big corrupted persons. So what we maybe missed in all this first effort to build a democracy in Tunisia is that we didn't watch it, what was happening with the economic old stakeholders. Obviously, the former president quitted to Saudi Arabia, but the big economic stakeholders and the economic system was still here. And they very early worked in a smart way to reorganize themselves. They reorganized themselves in parties. They bought private media. And we got, again, the same or even worse, sometimes organized system, but a very corrupted system, and sometimes worse, because before 2011, we got at least a strong state, a less threatening borders with Libya. Libya was more stable. So we have very hard challenges with our Libyan neighbor. Life and political life in our among our Algerian neighbor, a very also challenging security problems among migration. We have big waves of immigration coming from Côte d'Ivoire, from Senegal, from Mali, from Sahel countries, knowing terrorism and new rising security challenges. So we have dozens of immigrants coming from Sahel region, coming in Tunisia, willing to go to Europe, but it's also a new challenge. And with all this, it's really a hard time. And Tunisians were watching a corrupted parliament, and also, let's say, a bi-party or multi-party system, but just delivering for parties and trying to and showing that it was a democracy, improving just the lives of the parliamentarians and responding to the party's interests and needs. And Tunisians were at but the 25th of July very angry because they were watching that the country was like the parties were ganging on the population, on the Tunisian people. They were just here in the parliament struggling and just delivering for the people, the little group linked to the parties. So it wasn't a solution. For the moment, what is happening is still trying to have again a strong state, trying also to fix this problem of a corrupted parliament. It was really a problem. We got 7 smugglers in the parliament, and they were buying in a clear way the journalists to just hide some real problems in the Tunisian lives. Now we still need to watch what is happening, and we are willing to see that we have a new government with a woman on the head of the government and with 10 women in different strategic ministries. We hope that this government, with our president, with also the civil society actors and people, will reach out very soon, let's say, a dialogue and re-establish soon a system where we will organize elections and have a parliament. But before, we have really to fix the body of election, because the election body was corrupted and very linked to the parties, and the independence of the electoral body was in lost the last years. We have also to fix some points in the organization of the political life, how to organize the relation between the president and the prime minister, because what was adopted in the 2014 constitution clearly in the chapter linked to the political system clearly gave the country a weak system and, let's say, a fragmented system. And we want politicians to deliver by this 2014 political system. We got a very weak state with months in the parliament blocked laws and a strong blockage between the president and the prime minister. So we got since 2014, let's say, 3 heads in the political regime, but 3 weak heads with no one really delivering, with no one really deciding, just politicians fighting for more than 5 years. So we would like that as soon as possible we have some responses to this, but we still remain hopeful, and I still remain in a way positive, and I have no choice. My point is that We have to have some faith in civil society. The trade union is a big civil society actor. We as civil society actors, we still watch what is happening. There is also the union of the journalists, which is a strong body. And as I have to say also that we have a lot to say among democracy assistants, because also there is an evaluation to give. A lot was done, positive things were done, but also the governance of the assistants from UN system, from European Union system, from also USAID system gave a lot. But the way money was gave, and I'm sure that you know this, sometimes it was giving in a generous way, but sometimes just, let's say, sometimes recruiting young people, not knowing the field. And in a way, it was sometimes not always the good choices. I think we need in a way to rethink democracy assistance and rethink maybe some smart ways to be more present in the field among these young people who were angry and went to the streets in 25th of July. So I think that we can react. Maybe I said too much. I don't know if Larry, if you need me to talk again or if it is okay now.
We'll come back to another round. I do want to get to our last speaker. Before I do, I'll just summarize by saying that you've stressed four issues that I think often arise in the struggle to institutionalized democracy: the need to build effective states, the need to fight corruption, the need for a good infrastructure to neutrally administer free and fair elections, and the need to have adequate constitutional design. Ironically, in Tunisia, people wanted a weak president because they were scared of another Ben Ali, but then they got the opposite problem. In any case, South Africa certainly was aware of those challenges when it negotiated its transition in the early 1990s. And maybe it has some lessons to share as well as issues it's struggling with. I'd like to turn to Jay Naidu now.
Thanks, Larry. And it's a pleasure to be on this panel with all of you. We came very late in the running to democracy. So 1990 was probably in Africa one of the last countries to escape the clutches of apartheid and its form of internal colonialism. So we studied every revolution. We studied democracy across the West, across the East, in every country. We looked in particular at liberation movements and swore that we would never do the same. And we ended up with the liberation movement eating its children. So the question is, what did we miss? What do we have to unlearn? You know, I come from a life that from the time of 15 years old, I've been an activist, you know, first as a student activist, community organizer, going into the trade union movement as a leader with our current president, and then joining government and Mandela's cabinet. And I keep asking myself this question: what did I miss? It's not that we didn't have the best advice. We had an iconic leadership led by Nelson Mandela and his generation. We had probably the most robust civil society movement in the world. We had a vibrant, active citizenry. And that's how we ended apartheid. Not because we had great leaders, but because people at the end of the day stood up and said, we had enough. We refused to collaborate with our oppression. And so that's when people lose the fear of the oppressor, is the time of change. And so, of course, we entered into negotiations because there was certainly an environment in which we could not defeat them and they could not defeat us. And so we either faced the prospect of taking a low-scale civil war into an active civil war. And many in the world predicted that we will descend into a racial civil war. But we didn't, because we rose above our constituencies and found the common ground. And I think that's the extraordinary thing about South Africa's political miracle. But the question is, what have we done with this miracle? And that's where, you know, it counts today. You know, it's if you go back in our struggle for democracy, one person, one vote in a democratic, non-racial, non-sexist South Africa, that was the calling call of our liberation movement, on which we built a global movement supporting us and an internal mass struggle that brought us this freedom. And so we achieved that. And the Mandela generation, in fact, delivered on their promise, which is a constitutional democracy at the heart of which lay a commitment we made to address the legacy of inequality, of poverty, of racism, and to build a new country based on that principle. And so if I reflect on it, you know, 27 years later, you know, what do I see? I see, you know, state capture that has corroded our ability to even deliver the most fundamentally basic goods. You know, I'm actually late coming to the session because there's so much load shedding at the moment. And yet our power producer was one of the most efficient in the world. And we have to ask, how can people who I would have taken a bullet for commit to destroying the fabric of our society to such an extent that is now called state capture? And there's a judicial commission of inquiry into the role of the former president and others allied to him in undermining our democracy. So I think the second thing that I want to raise is that, what is democracy? And I think we have to go back to the drawing boards. This is something I was prepared to give my life for. But today, 18 million young, mostly black, young South Africans don't even bother to register a vote. We've got an election coming up here on the 1st of November for local government elections, and it's basically no interest. And every time we have a conversation with young people, say, but why should I vote? They don't care about us. And if I start looking at issues of election funding, if I start looking at the ways in which lists of parties are drawn up, all power has now centralized in the hands of those that are the party bosses. So the system is rigged. It's almost impossible to break into it. And so, you know, young people feel completely alienated from it, and trust has broken down. But trust has broken down not just in the political architecture, it's broken down in everything. You know, it's broken down in business, even in trade unions. I'm a trade union leader. But the world has changed. The technological revolution has redefined the notion of work. So we're still promising jobs when there will be no jobs created. So what are we doing about livelihoods? What are we doing as this technological revolution replaces jobs and the production line as we knew it, and mechanization, artificial intelligence, and nanotechnology take over? How do we redefine? What do we do with ourselves? What do we do with time? What are the creative sectors that will arise? What are the things we need to put into place so that we can start to think about, you know, a new way of living? And it comes at the middle of an ecological emergency. I think we're at a point where we have to question everything and everyone who did anything. We have to ask ourselves some pretty hard questions and not try to offer solutions, because we have no solutions. But it's an exciting moment in which we can reimagine, rethink, reorganize, and redesign a world that is living in harmony between ourselves as human beings and humanity, but also a harmony with Mother Earth on which we live. So I think we're going into an exciting roller coaster, and we're the last generation potentially that has the ability to redefine what it means to be human. Why am I here? Who am I? And I think that really particularly important for me at this moment is that Mother Earth that I'm really concerned about. You know, she's been here 4.5 billion years. There's been 5 extinctions already, and she takes 15 to 25 million years to recover from it. This is the one, the Anthropocene, that we are responsible for, our arrogance and our greed and our notions of dominion. And so if we question ourselves about that, it's a very fundamental rethinking we got to have, and we can't throw it to China or Russia. You know, I don't care a damn what any country wants to do in Africa, because every country has an agenda. The United States certainly has an agenda. So does Russia, so does Europe, so does China, so does India. The question really, we are 54 fiefdoms still defined by the Berlin Conference of 1834. And we still have leaders that think that they have some divine right to rule over us. And I think that's what has to change. And it's only young people that are capable of the changes that can be made. You wouldn't find old people like us leading revolutions. It's young people, like we saw in the North African, you know, uprisings, or like we saw in apartheid, or like we saw in any struggle. So I think we're at a point where we really have to ask ourselves the question, have we earned the right to live on this planet? Let me leave it at that.
Great. Thank you so much. I think we heard again some of the big causal driving themes that President Kwasniewski began our conversation with, including this massive challenge that most of our societies are facing of deepening inequality within our societies. And of course, you sounded as well the question of whether the institutional designs in South Africa, with the kind of party elites dominating and this phenomenon of exclusion all over again, you've articulated it in a different way, might occasion some rethinking about the constitutional structure in South Africa. You didn't put it that way, but some of us at the time thought, well, it's very inclusive, it's very proportional, but that does tend to give a lot of power to party elites. And that was the problem you were articulating. Oh, okay, I'd like to return for a second round to the four of you. And to start with President Kwasniewski and with the president of NDI, maybe I should call you president as well, Derek Mitchell, and ask you if you could to, of course, react to everything you've heard, but maybe to drill down a little bit more into what this could mean for a democracy support agenda, if at a time when that question is lurking with the democracy summit just around the corner. So you might say a bit more about what you think could emerge from the summit in terms of a common agenda among the democracies. We haven't talked about global media or media within our countries very explicitly. Mr. President, you did raise the issue of social media, which is, I think, posing great challenges to us now, polarization and division. But independent media are under pressure in a lot of these countries, have been captured, as Ms. Jablawi noted, in Tunisia. So is there more that the wealthy democracies could do in that regard, illuminate with the support of and partnership of the National Endowment for Democracy, the creation of a well-funded international trust for independent media? But anyway, I just kind of pose these questions and invite, kind of a drilling down more into some specific ideas of what might be done to support a rebooting of democracy work and practice around the world and a defense against democratic erosion. President Kwasniewski, could we start with you again?
Thank you. So first of all, I would like to thank my colleagues because the insights were extremely interesting and from different points of the world. I appreciate it very much. Then Democratic Summit and all these events, I think that is very important because it means that we understand the situation is dangerous, that it's time to react, that we cannot believe that everything will go smoothly without our engagement, without our activities. The point number two is democracy is, generally speaking, is easy to define what means democracy, what kind of values we have to protect, but practically it's very difficult to put all kind of all forms of democracies to one basket, because we have different historical experiences, we have different mentalities, we have different geographical situation, we have different economic situations. So I don't believe that if we want to prepare some one model for everybody, it will work. We should protect the values, free election, human rights, rights of minorities, rights of women, etc., etc. But we should see democracy as the field with hundreds of flowers, different flowers. But that is next important point to have such approach. Third thing, third point is we need some practical signs or some evidence that democracy is working correctly. And I think there is special responsibilities on the side of the United States. I tell you, I'm not very objective here, of course, because I never was a fan of Donald Trump, but I think what President Trump did in the last, in his term, it was really very, very, it was a disaster, frankly speaking. For the future of democracy, it was a disaster because it showed that the center of democracy, the country where we believed that democracy is very, very deep-rooted, is possible to have such ideas which create total irresponsibility, arrogance, such very, let's say, arrogant approach to democratic values, etc. So I think America should show now that democracy is something serious. That is not only the system of election, but that is something serious in sense of values. And of course, for me, it's very difficult to say it because still I feel myself as a part of Polish history. But when European Union is very tough to in reaction against all these irregularities which we have in Poland, especially in the judicial system, I'm in favor of European Union. That is probably not very nice because I should be with such patriotic feeling on the side of my government, but I'm not. Because if in Europe we have to survive, we have to protect all these values. So this is the next point. The countries which or the entities where this democracy is developed, they have to protect and to be strong in protection of the values. If we will start to make some compromises about independence of judiciary, of human rights, or rights of women, that is the end of democracy at all. And we cannot say that in Burma or in China or in Indonesia or somewhere they should have good democracy with good protection or fulfillment of these values. Mm-hmm. Point number four, media, of course. Media today is also a real fear for democracy because the amount of fake news, of manipulation is too big. What we can do, how we can control the system, at least of fake news, that is an open question for me. I don't know. But that is something what is necessary to do, at least as a show two sources of information. Because if you want to, in the future, we want to fight against pandemic and we'll have on one side the voice of good experts, and the other side, the voice of all this, self-made experts, and this voice will have the same weight, we have no chances to organize our life. So that is the real problem. And the last problem is a question of leadership, of politicians. My good advice to the democratic politicians in the world is, in your practice, you have to be transparent. You cannot be corrupted. You should believe in all these democratic values. And if you want to organize strategy, my simple message is more vision, less television. It means more great ideas, more strategies, and not so much PR, not so much all these, political technologies, all this, manipulation. More vision, less television, and then for democracy, we have some chances to win.
Okay, I'm going to remember that line, and I hope I will always remember to quote you when I use it.
Please.
Let me say that one thing I think the Biden administration is doing is stressing the importance of each country being humble and self-reflective in coming up with a plan at the democracy summit for addressing its own democracy challenges and deficits. And I'll just say, I think the US presence, the US delegation at the democracy summit is gonna be pretty straightforwardly, again, to use the word, humble and thoughtful and forthright in putting forth its own kind of action agenda for addressing some of our own increasingly stark democracy deficits in the United States. It's a little bit tricky because, you can't get too partisan when you do this, but you also can't ignore the obvious. So Derek, over to you.
Thank you, Larry. And I appreciated the real president's remarks. I am a president, but not like he is a president. Taking up what you just said, Larry, and what President Kwasniewski said, it absolutely is true. The United States needs to be a model to the degree that it just simply leads wherever, whatever we do, we will lead. And we can lead in a negative direction. And the degradation of democracy in our own country will lead, unfortunately, as a model for others who will look at that and say, well, that's acceptable. Look what happened on January 6th, or look what happened last week. And that's very, very destructive. And it is a fact that you cannot have, unfortunately, there are some US politicians who promote democracy abroad, but don't necessarily promote democracy at home in the same way. And that is a contradiction. I can say that, without partisanship, but it is a problem because it gets to the issue I mentioned earlier, about young people, about investing in the next generation as the hope on this, the energy for this. They're out in the streets angry at everyone, at all governance. It's not just against democracy, it's against the authoritarians, whether it's Hong Kong or it's in Tunisia, whatever. People are frustrated at bad governance, and really it's corrupt governance. And what they're looking for, if we expect them to be different, we would hope that there'd be some models that they give me. What are the models for younger people to follow? Who are the mentors that they would look to that we can organize to say, this is the way it can be or should be. Here's a path forward. Otherwise, they will, unfortunately, as oftentimes, we're always investing in young people and they always get older and then you invest in more young people. They'll just follow with what they know. They may just get into the system. The system is the way it is, and it will corrupt them the same way or is structured in a way where they will not succeed. So thinking about that fundamentally, and I think, what went wrong, NDI has done that thinking, well, where do we might have gotten it wrong in the last 30 years or 20 years when we had thought things had gone well? And the one thing that I would diagnose, and I wasn't with NDI for all of the 20 years, is that mindsets change slowly. That culture change, cultural change is hard. And that oftentimes that first generation, it's easy to have an election. It's easy to start political parties or have structures, but the culture will change more slowly. And that first generation, they just, you have folks who will game the system. And you have to have some kind of break where the system maybe younger people figure out, or we can help folks to think about, how do you change that system to ensure that there is better democratic governance? And the way you will deliver practically is with more transparent, more accountable, more inclusive, more representative governance. And I think the foundational issue, we have to fight the cynicism. The cynicism that is out there, that a pox in all their houses, there's no reason to vote, there's no reason to be engaged, is very, very pernicious. And I think is played by some of the authoritarians, because they'll say, you're right, the system is bad, only I can fix it. Give me the power and I'll deliver for you. And that's where the populism comes in. And that never truly delivers. It just makes things even worse. And we've been in that swing back and forth now. On the issue of information, just very quickly, I don't go on too long. Disinformation, I've always felt that digital will kill democracy. That, you know, it's wonderful to speak through a screen to everybody. You can get wider audiences. It's great to meet people on the screen, but I'm not actually meeting President Kwasniewski or my other fellow panelists. It's a different dynamic for democracy when you have the analog connection. And even with independent media, you're going to have to deal with people who won't necessarily figure out what is fact or fiction. And lies are, the ability to peddle lies is very strong. The Chinese are trying to do it, the Russians are trying to do it, and every oligarch is trying to do it. So fighting the information battle is fundamental. And that gets to the demand side, that gets to the individual of figuring out how to be a smarter consumer of information and determine. And without that, without a strong information foundation, democracy will never succeed. That is the long pole in the tent, in my view. You have to have a firm grasp of common information that you debate, have conversations about, compromise with that new culture. Otherwise, we are in for much more frustration, much more cynicism going forward.
First, I will unmute, and then I will say that I think we mustn't lose sight of the core insight that people who've been in the social media companies and left in disgust, have increasingly been sounding, that the model of all these social media companies is a perverse and unsustainable model. And it is to feed fear, suspicion, anger, outrage, and so on, because it's what fixates people on their social media platforms and enables them to sell more advertising and capture more profit. So I think we have radical work to do in the United States, where most of these tech companies are based, to address these hard issues. I'd like to return to Emna and Jay now, and begin with this brief observation. A hypothesis, really, that maybe you were victims of your own success. In each case, your transitions actually had a lot of similarities. You faced challenges of violence and unraveling and had enormous challenges to negotiate the transition. But you also had very inspiring success. And in the case of South Africa, a leader who comes along on the world stage, you know, if you're lucky, once in two generations in a single country. So, maybe we were lured into a false sense of optimism that it would be smooth sailing. Now you've each eloquently, I think cogently, noted a lot of the challenges with the way democracy worked after your transitions and all of the deficits. So I wonder if you could illuminate us from your national perspectives and from your regional perspectives, what would you like to see now from Europe and the United States in terms of democracy support? What specifically would you like to see both state providers of democracy assistance and developmental assistance and non-governmental providers like the National Democratic Institute do now to try and help you, you know, reconstruct or resurrect and correct your democracies that have gone off the rail or are in danger of doing so. Emna, we'll start with you again.
So thank you, Larry, for this question. And I appreciate a lot. I have to thank Club de Madrid and all of you guys for your interest about what is happening in Tunisia. We were very happy to be part of the Club of Democracies and thought that it was done. But as you all know, transition is not about 1 year or even 10 years. I'm sure that the Polish president know that it's a long process, and it's even more complex for us because in North Africa, in Arabic region, it's even more challenging. So it's a hard exercise. But I have to say to Derek, my friend Derek, because I watched what was NDI gave as assistant in assistance in Tunisia. We were happy that you were here. You helped a lot, parliamentary groups and parties, but you didn't enough supported civil society actors. So my recommendation, and we can discuss it again more thoroughly, I'm open to it, is maybe to give more balanced assistance, not just all the funding to the parties, because we saw that the parties sometimes weren't always enough responsible and just watched their own little microsystem or ecosystem. And there is a big problem of confidence in the parties now among young people. So if you want to gain some new, let's say, attractiveness to the democracy among youngs, and to, if you want to gain again, because what we lived was also questioning, do we want democracy or do we prefer security and a strong state? And it's still a question. And each, let's say, day is also a question to this. And we still need, I think, because we still want to be a democracy. I think Tunisian people want freedom. They are enough well-educated. But it is another way to manage all this. So the democracy assistance, I think, should maybe focus on more support to civil society actors, but a lot also need to be done with the state to have, because it was not very clear. And as you can imagine, sometimes some civil society actors were highly linked to the parties. Some of them, sometimes we have some problem about linked NGOs to violent extremism and linked to some groups who went to Syria. So a lot need also to be questioned among this, the choice, and even again, the values that we have to share. We need to help support those who share our values, mainly the freedom and freedom of speech and so on. So mainly also, I have to say, if we want to still make some, let's say, make democracy still attractive in my country, because it's also the debate in Tunisia. People are angry. People are sometimes saying, maybe we need a strong regime and we need prosperity. We need economic prosperity. We need to eat. We need to have a good, let's say, prosperous life. So for me, democracy is also about prosperity. It needs to make people happy, and it needs. So maybe we forgot about it. And what democracy assistance from Europe, from United States, asked the last 10 years to the political actors, you just ask to them to organize elections. It's not enough. And between elections, you just supported this formal system, which was a corrupted one. So for me, if we need maybe to save this fragile, still open and still possible emerging democracy, it's very it's the time. It's the time, but we need to be more humble, as Larry said, to try to understand the complexity of the field, the, let's say, the specificity of each country. Each country is a complex reality. Maybe the values are clearly the same, but the way we implement it and the way we fight for them, we need to discuss it and to do it in a smart way. So if we want still young people not to dream about being in a close regime, I think we have to ask to the new stakeholders to see the economic system, because one of the failures is that we gave the governance of the country to still the old people who didn't change anything among custom systems, among the laws. Nothing was changed really in the reforming. And you were so kind. I was seeing my friends in European Union still supporting the country, supporting the different prime ministers. We got at least 9 or 10. Each year we got a new prime minister, a very each year they were supporting the new prime minister, but never asking why reforms were not done. Nothing was done about reforming economic system, reforming laws, about reforming judiciary system, which is very important. And reforming is not just about giving money and maybe giving money to one big NGO or maybe one big company, because we don't have enough resources to watch the way money is spent, and just coming once a year to discuss with the prime minister and do some photos. It's not about this. It's also about, we gave you support. We want to see, did reforms really want was giving? We still have a very old economic system. We still have a system, let's say, a closed system. For example, central bank is like the 60s system. So we still don't have PayPal. We still don't have an open economy. So it was an open political system, but still not open economy. Does the democracy means open political system and not open economic system? So it's one of the questions I wanted to raise. And again, thank you everybody for your interest. I still have some faith in it. I'm still optimistic. So let's meet in some time again and to discuss this.
Great. So Jay, the same question or challenge to you.
Yes, I'm loving what I'm hearing, because I think anyone who says they have solutions to this is lying through their teeth. We don't have solutions. In fact, we should try to think, what are the right questions to ask ourselves? I'm one that really didn't believe in assistance to South Africa. I think we needed assistance in our struggle against apartheid, but we're a rich country. And we should have the wherewithal to do it ourselves, to determine what is democracy, to have the conversations. We don't need some external partner trying to support us to do that, except where we invite the ideas. Where I come out of the union movement, we met in the sugarcane fields and under the trees and community halls, not in five-star hotels. And I have this thing today of people saying, when we're having a meeting to discuss an urgent challenge in the society, and they ask, do you have money for transport? And do you have money to book a hotel?
Oh.
This is something completely foreign to me. The idea of democracy is something to be fought for, with passion. So I think that, for me, the idea of international assistance always comes with an agenda. Now, sometimes the agenda may be a benevolent one, but in most cases it's not. It's linked to a foreign policy of a particular government and linked to their ideas, their value systems, their ideology. So I've not been one that encouraged too often the idea of direct assistance, especially at a bilateral, as Elena pointed out, in the formal channels, because it never reaches the people it should reach. And it gets dropped into a big, deep hole of the predatory elites that already have captured the state or benefit from the state. And so, yes, you know, if you do the statistics on bilateral assistance to even civil society, even in international NGOs of note, what do we find? You know, one of the research studies we did is practically in gender-based violence, that probably 8% reaches the leaders at a local level. There is something fundamentally wrong, even with the international assistance programs on everything. And I think often my conversations with young people is they see NGOs and even now trade unions, from which I come, as part of the problem, not part of the solution. So surely they're sending us a message to say, listen, can we build an authentic, genuine, intergenerational dialogue and cooperation? But don't come and lecture us about what you've done in your past. And so if we can recognize that and have just a little bit more humility, I mean, the United States should be the last one talking about democracy. You're a country practically in civil war. And that was very obvious in the Trump times, you know? There's a deep wound in that society that's 500 years that you're not paying attention to. And that wound continues to fester. And until you take that wound out and say, whether it's a wound of superiority or a wound of inferiority, it is a wound that needs healing. The same thing with South Africa. You think that we have a democracy that's constitutional and we have great, you know, institutions protecting democracy and the free elections, that we've got rid of racism in this country. No. What we saw 2 months ago is an explosion in this country, because racism is still very much alive in this country. And the economy and the wealth of this country is still predominantly in the hands of a white minority. Okay, it looks a bit like salt and pepper, more salt than pepper today, with a few black politically connected individuals that have become billionaires and that control politics. And the last point I want to raise, Larry, is that, you know, I mean, coming out of the Second World War was a devastating crisis we had. 60 million people killed, enormous physical damage. And we had a world that didn't know where to start. And so the emergence of multilateralism and even democracy was a very real benefit to everyone. How do we prevent a war on this scale in future? And I think it did its job very well for a period of time, but it's 75 years old now. You know, it's like a chassis of an old antique car. And so, you know, if you have an antique, which I don't, you probably take it out one Sunday a year. You don't use it in your day-to-day life. So there's something fundamentally wrong with the construct of the governance architecture internationally, from international down to continental, down to the local level. And when young people question that, we want to fight back, because we're a generation that's holding on to power longer than any other generation in the world. So I think we have to ask ourselves, what are we going to do to allow this debate to take place and promote it, even if they are throwing rotten eggs at you, because I have that often at me. And I'm very happy to take it. And I often tell people, you know, if you want to know about the mistakes I made, you need a week in which I can talk to you about that. So let's think about a different way now.
Thank you. I want to thank you all for your, you know, just deeply inspiring and eloquent remarks, not least the final ones we heard from Jay Naidu and Emna Jablawi just before, and President Kwasniewski and Derek Mitchell. This has been a challenging session because the issues are challenging and the realities are painful. But I think we've heard some common themes in terms of the need, which we need to keep reminding ourselves, for democracy support efforts to approach this work in a spirit of humility and in a spirit of partnership. We have things in the United States we can learn from the rest of the world. And I think what the last few years have taught us is kind of we're all in this together in terms of trying to fight the tendencies toward state capture, which we had in the last few years in the U.S., inequality, corruption, which goes on, marginalization. President Kwasniewski from the very beginning used the word political exclusion, which and social exclusion and marginalization, which has its painful and democratically debilitating manifestation in each of our countries that we've been talking about. So I hope this dialogue will continue. I thank the Club de Madrid for the extraordinary work it's doing to raise these issues and advance this intellectual debate. And now I hand the floor back to Jamie Angus. Thank you all so much.
Well, thank you very much, Larry. What an extraordinary panel that was, and you moderated it incredibly well, if I may say so. Thank you to you and all your panelists for a really, really riveting hour and a half. Ladies and gentlemen, I know it's been an intensive and productive session, and we're very grateful for your attention and your comments. Today, we've discussed issues such as pandemics, climate change and terrorism, among other global threats, and how our responses to them will determine citizens' trust in democracy. We've identified policy recommendations to strengthen democracy's system of checks and balances, and we found ways in which polarized societies can heal their divisions for the common good, addressing some misconceptions around the current state of democracy support. Now, please stay with us, though, because we want to transition seamlessly to our final session of the day. As we did yesterday, we want to shine a spotlight on our topic of rethinking democracy. But first, let me remind you that tomorrow is the last day of our policy dialogue. We'll be live from 10 a.m. European Central Time with a compelling session which will be devoted to proving democracy still works and can improve people's lives in tangible ways. So, to today's final session, Democracia en Español, if I may, reflections on the state of democracy, a conversation between the former Prime Minister of Spain, Felipe González, and the former President of Costa Rica, Laura Chinchilla. And this session will be in Spanish, but you can follow it in English by pressing the translation button. Meanwhile, I wish everyone a pleasant end to your day, and I look forward to seeing you back here tomorrow morning, 10 a.m. Central European Time. Thank you very much.